Chip. It's the morning star drive 107.8. You soaring up with sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
Hey guys, how's it going? It's Tuesday, November 22nd, and this is the Morning Star Drive on 117.8. We're on YouTube, so make sure to subscribe, follow us on SoundCloud, and make sure to support us on Patreon. So what is happening on this wonderful Tuesday? We've got current news from around the world, the practical word study, and of course, Pravi in the media. All right, everyone, how are you doing today? It is Tuesday, yes, and I hope you guys are enjoying your week. Monday is in the books, and yes, that hardest day of the week is done, so now we can just kick into gear and put these words of God into action. Super thankful all you guys joining us here on the Morning Star Drive, so let's keep liking, keep commenting, want to hear from you guys and see how you are doing. And most importantly, if anything else comes out of this podcast, it is to build a community here in this history, a community where we can express ourselves, talk about the things that we normally can't talk about in our own churches or with our friends. But I hope that we can have a place here that's very transparent and a place where all of us can open our hearts and our minds to each other. I just want to remind everyone also, there's Q&A Thursday coming up. And get your questions ready for this week. Would love to hear if you guys have anything going on in your life right now. Questions that you would like to know maybe what Sunseem said about it or what does the Bible say about it also, all right? So Q&A is one of the most popular segments we have every week. So I enjoy it too, just going into it and trying to remember or study on what Sunseem has said about some of these questions you guys bring up. So thankful for already the question that has come in, just came in last night. So super thankful all of you guys are already sending in questions. Well, I hope you guys had a wonderful Monday. For me, I came on October 29th. So I'm 3 weeks in and, just about 8 days, no, like 7 days. I'm just 1 week away from having a full month here. And if you think about this, guys, we're like a week away from the end of November, which is pretty crazy if you think about that too. So this month is ending really, really fast. I'm kind of excited because I'm planning a trip with my parents and they're going to be flying over here to Malaysia. So I'm with some members. I am planning like a 5-country trip in about 3 weeks. But, you know, it's just tentative right now because my parents are both over 70. I don't want them to travel too much. But definitely, they're flying over here to Malaysia. So we'll be in Malaysia. And then we'll head over to Singapore, Indonesia, Vietnam, and Thailand. So it should be a really fun trip. And I hope it's a good trip for my parents, you know. And I'm thinking they don't want to travel that much. I'm sure they want to enjoy time in certain countries too. So I just want to see, let's see what type of trip we can make out of this one too. So I had an interesting experience, by the way. Just last week, I forgot to bring this up on yesterday. Remember I told you guys I went to visit that former faith church and talk about the praise and everything else. And they have something what you call a connect group. And it's like every fortnight, right? So every 2 weeks, we meet at someone's, it's my first time joining. They meet at someone's house and it's just a time of like small groups, a very, very quick Bible study to go into something. But I found it very, very interesting. And I went there just to kind of check out what makes, what brings such a good community over there in the Christian church, right? And it was really interesting. So this is kind of what the format it was like. There's about 20, 25 people that went over to one of the members' houses, right, in the former faith church. Huge house, really, really nice. And they open it up every single time. They're a really, really good group of people. And it starts off with food, right? So, you know, people go over there around 7 p.m. and there's food, like tons of food. And then there's going to be an icebreaker. And then they watch, and then after the icebreaker, there's a little time of praise. They watch through a video. And then they're watching a video for the Connect group. And it's their pastor talking to another pastor. And they're discussing about certain topics. And it's about 15 minutes, it's very, very short. And this week they talked about intercessory prayer, right? Someone who's, who's in between God and like, you know, the person who's like a mediator, a midway person through, through people, for people who are unsaved or people who are struggling and stuff like that too. So it was really nice to watch, 15 minutes. It was really, really good. And then you break into small groups, have a time of discussion, and then you just chill. Like after that, and it was so crazy. Like it was such a comfortable, relaxed night that when we finished, it was already like past midnight. It was like 12:30. It was past midnight, and I was like, wow, this is, you know, it's so chill, it's so relaxed. And I'm going to tell you this, the biggest difference I saw Okay, so the biggest difference between I see this community and our community is that in this church, there are no separations. I'm not talking male and female. I'm talking about departments. It's separated by region, not by departments, right? So people come to the small groups. There's SS there. There's campus, career. There's families. Everyone is there. And it was just a very different feeling just to be connected and like everyone's together. There's no disconnect between the parents and families and stuff like that too. Like I sat there chilling, talking to two SS. They're like 14 and 15 years old. Later on, I talked to someone who's in their career. I talked to the parents. It was just really, really good time together. And it just felt super stable and very, very connected. And I thought that was a very interesting way of having these connect groups, right? And I thought to myself, yeah, you know what? That might be a good idea also for Providence, not to be separating too much like by department, like only career group comes out. We don't want, or the SS don't want to see their parents. But when I saw how these parents were, they were funny. They were praying for everyone. They were really involved, right? Even during the praise, they were just like the kids, hands in the air, eyes were closed, just praising God. And I thought that was quite amazing to see it at that level. And I thought to myself, man, to build a really good community, you know, I think it's a very good thing to have like all groups. Like it wouldn't be a bad idea to have all departments there, like whoever can make it. And it's split by region more than department. You know, like if I live close, it's very, very easy for me to go over. But if it's really far away, then people are going to have a hard time like, oh, I can't make it. It's a little bit far for me kind of thing, or people need rides and stuff, right? But I found it very, very interesting. And you know what? You want to know what the most interesting part was? I was talking to another member about it, like going, yeah, I went to visit this. It was very interesting. And the first thing they said, which I thought was interesting is, oh, is it an evangelism event? And the answer is no. And I think that's another thing that made it very, very comfortable. It had nothing to do with evangelism. It was just a time to bring people together. That's it. There wasn't a goal of let's make an event so we can evangelize people. And I think that's one of the things that I believe we lack in Providence is more fellowship. Just being with each other, hanging out with each other, talking with each other, being cool with, like that was something I looked at and said, oh, that is so interesting. I think that would be something where evangelism isn't the goal. It's just to be like a family, to be a connected community. And if that actually happened, then evangelism would actually be more natural, right? And it would happen just because everyone was cool. Like that was a group that after I left, I'm like, oh, I can hang out with them again. No problem. And these parents are just like what? 10, like not even 10 years older than me, right? And they were funny too. And they were funny talking. We just had a good time. So I was looking at that and thinking to myself, I was like, wow, maybe we separate ourselves too much. Like not just male and female, but like more like departments. And we lose a lot of that, I'm not sure what it is. Like when we're playing the icebreaker games, like the guys add the competitiveness and they're really into it. The girls add a certain part. The families add a certain part. It was just really, really an amazing time. And I thought that was something I really wanted to share. Like, man, we got to build this community in Providence. We got to build it in such a natural, organic way. But in order to do that, you'd have to take evangelism out of the picture. Like, you couldn't have that as the goal, right? Sports, the goal shouldn't be evangelism. I think it's just to play sports. Right, and if it's everyone's having a good time, then it's everyone's gonna have a good time, right? So that was something, and I think it would solve one of the issues. Is for instance, if we keep separating males and females, and we keep separating these departments, like we always come up with this. I'm tell me guys, if this problem persists with you guys too, is write in the comments below. Is like since the girls and guys are so separated, but if you want it, like if you have a male that wants to bring a female, you can't bring them because it's only males. And then these females have like colleagues and coworkers and friends that are the opposite sex, but they can't bring them because the event is only for girls kind of thing. You know what I mean? And when you have it very natural and everyone just hanging out with each other, I think it's a lot easier than trying to just separate everything in such a strict way. So that's kind of one of the thoughts that I had in my mind. One of the bigger things, guys, I forgot to mention this yesterday too. Yesterday was my 700th episode. Tell me that is crazy. 700 episodes. I can't believe we've already reached this milestone. Super grateful, super thankful for everyone who listens in the Morningstar Drive. And I'm still really thankful to God we reached 700 episodes. And super thankful that God has given me the heart to do this. And, you know, I'm really hoping to see, like, we already have some stuff in line where we're going to grow this, we're going to grow this programming even more, right? And we're going to, I'm hoping to get some standalone shows. So we have the MSD, you know, like the podcast, but some people are asking, like, there's some people I think that can do like standalone programs. And I think that would be kind of cool too. Like separate shows that will be showing on the Morningstar Drive. So I'm excited about that also. But I'm thankful to God because this podcast has been a great outlet for me, especially during the pandemic when I was really, really struggling. Through this podcast, I was disciplined, I was responsible, I was researching the word, right? Talking about things that I really care about, also things I really felt needed to be addressed. And, you know, I really wanted to address things, especially when it came to transparency and the way we organize, the way we deal with people inside the church, the way we treat the church members, like the leadership and the members, like all these things I had in my mind because I experienced it. I was a leader, I was a member, and all these things I thought to myself is, you know, we could do better with this, you know? Like the way it is right now, it kind of builds in some areas, like very toxic cultures in some areas, right? And through this podcast, I was really able to express myself and also be able to connect with other people out there who notice the same thing, right? And over the last, since 2020, 316, 2020, that's when this started, right? So it's already been 2 years and then 2.5 years already, guys. It's been 2.5 years, going on 3 years very, very soon. Within the next 4 months, we're going to be at 3 years on this podcast. I am super grateful and thankful. And man, this Morningstar Drive podcast, I'm thankful. The biggest thing is it has saved me during the pandemic, right? Studying the word, focusing on the Bible, focusing on things that are beneficial to myself and to members. And big, big thank you and thanksgiving, not only to you guys, but especially to the Holy Trinity for opening my heart to this, knowing what I'd be going through during that pandemic time. So happy 700th episode, which was yesterday. Today is 701, but very grateful and thankful. So yeah, just I'm just so amazed and awesome. I'm so thankful for all these things either way. Right. Also, we have Pravi in the media. Right. Pravi in the media today is going to be our last segment. I'm going to talk about Sunseem's trial situation, what happened on November 18th, and then go over the next trial and what's going to be happening on from this point on. And if you know, every Tuesday is Pravi in the media. You guys are going to get some information on Sunseem's trials or what's happening or what's the media's relationship to like cults and to Providence or just to like new religious movements in general. So today we'll be going over Sunseem's situation. His trial situation, just seeing what actually happened during that trial on last Thursday, I believe, or Friday. Was it Friday? Thursday or Friday? I think it was Friday. And then I'll be, we'll just talk about things that we should be praying for at that time too. All right. So I have a new poll out right now. So let's take a look at this over there on the Morningstar Drive. What is the new poll? And the new poll is about how transparent is your church with Sunseem's situation right now. With Sunseem's current situation, I just wanted to see what it was like out there. How transparent are your churches? Is it very, very open and transparent? Like everything comes out in real time. Everyone knows what's going on. It's very detailed. Or is it not that it's still transparent? You'll get the news you'll get the news here and there, maybe not as detailed and not on time. And then of course you have the other two is sometimes like you have to really ask a lot to get the information what's going on with Sunseem. And the worst one obviously is going to be zero transparency. Like if I didn't say anything on this podcast, then you probably would think that nothing was going on because you hear nothing from your churches. So I just want to see what your churches were like and how they were doing with this situation, with Sunseem's situation, which is very, very serious. And I hope it's something that you guys can take a look at, think about, and pray about too when it comes to your own church situation too. Okay? So you know what? Actually, today is supposed to be practical word study, but I prepared the wrong one today. So today, instead of the practical word study, I'm going to do the scripture, and I'll do practical word study tomorrow. I just I prepared the wrong one today, so I'm sorry about that. That's one less day of doing that, but I will definitely do practical word study for the Wednesday podcast. Okay, so there it is. So let's. Oh, by the way, Espresso with Sky. If you guys haven't seen it yet, that's mine. Is about my haunted apartment. So you know when I saw the spirit of that spirit lying next to me in my bed. Yeah, that one. So go ahead and check that one out. It's a pretty freaky one, but I hope you guys enjoy that too. All right. So let's get the show started with some member music from around the world. And today's feature artist of the day is none other than Dire Wings from Korea on this awesome Tuesday, and this is our latest song that just dropped about 3 weeks ago. This song is called I Feel Like That, and then we have AG from Japan with Love Is Eternal, and then we'll end things off with Juustar from New Zealand with Crystal Clear. Just because you hate me doesn't mean I'm not cool. 누군가의 반응 따위로 날 정하긴 좀 웃기잖아. Sometimes I feel that it's so well 알아 좀 그래. 때론 설명하기 참 그래. 근데 다 이유가 있더라고. There's a reason for every flaw. That's why I'm on my way. 걸음걸음마다 알지 못해도 걸어가다 보면 길이 이어져.
너를 케어하는 게 없네. 이끌려 쉴만한 물가로 언제나 그랬듯 뒤돌아보면 걸어온 길이 증명해주니까. 걸음걸음마다 알지 못해도 걸어가다 보면 길이 이어져. Yeah, so cool. I feel that I'm cool. What I felt was real. That's real. Feels so right. I feel. Just gotta do it in the matter of who is doing it. Who cares? Who cares?
crystal clear waters of blue. It feels like 17 years since I saw you, and I've been waiting for a chance to come back, back to the river where we met, back to the river to the fair. Crystal clear thoughts in my mind. When I get tangled up, you help me unwind. The voice of reason when times are hard. Your heart is pleasing, pleasing to God.
And that was Jewstar from New Zealand with the song Crystal Clear. Before that, AG from Japan with Love is Eternal. And of course, featured artist of the day, that's Dio Wings from Korea with I Feel Like That. All right, so let's get into some news going on around the world. And as brides of this history, we've got to know what's going on so we can pray for it. Top three reasons why we watch the world news. Number one, see what we need to report and pray for. Two, see what God is doing. And three, what are the things we need to comfort God's heart in? So let's start off with what is happening in Russia and the Ukraine. Explosions at occupied nuclear site in Ukraine. More than a dozen powerful explosions have been recorded near a huge Russian-occupied nuclear power plant in South Ukraine since Saturday evening. The head of the UN nuclear watchdog, Rafael Grossi, made an urgent appeal for a stop to the fighting at the Zaporizhzhia plant, Europe's biggest. And he said, whoever is behind this, it must stop immediately. You're playing with fire. The plant stands on the River Dnipro on the front line in the war. Russia's military accused Ukrainian forces on the other side of the river of shelling the area under its control. There was no immediate word from the Ukrainians, who have previously suggested Russian forces shell the area themselves despite having their troops there. The area around the plant, including the nearby Russian-occupied town of Enerhodar, had been under regular attack for months, but there had been a period of calm before the new explosions this weekend, which continued into Sunday morning. Monitors from Mr. Grossi's organization, the International Atomic Energy Agency, the IAEA, witnessed some of the explosions from their windows. Citing information provided by officials at the Russian control plant, the IAEA team said there had been damage to some building systems, some buildings, systems, and equipment at the site, but nothing so far critical for nuclear safety and security. There were no reports of casualties either, thank God. Russian state media quoted an official from Russian nuclear power operator Rosenergoatom as saying 15 shells have been fired at the plant's facilities, landing near a dry nuclear waste storage facility and a building that houses fresh spent nuclear fuel. But no radioactive emissions had been detected. The plant was overrun by Russian forces a few weeks after Moscow invaded Ukraine on February 24th. Russia annexed the Zaporizhzhia region and other Ukrainian territory in September, but has been pushed back on the battlefield in the south, notably in Kherson region, and the two armies face each other across the River Dnipro, all right? So that's what's happening over there, Russia and Ukraine. Let's go over to Malaysia, where I am, and they just had elections over the weekend. But Malaysia elects their first ever hung parliament. An inconclusive general election in Malaysia has produced the country's first ever hung parliament. Opposition leader Anwar Ibrahim secured the most seats, but his Pakatan Harapan alliance fell well short of a majority. The ruling coalition led by Ismail Sabri Yaakob suffered its worst electoral defeat ever, winning just 30 of the 178 seats it ran for. Veteran politician Mahathir Mohamad lost his seat, suffering his first defeat in 53 years. At 97 years old, Mr. Mahathir has dominated Malaysian politics for decades, first serving as the country's prime minister from 1981 to 2003, and he was credited for the country's rapid economic transformation from the 80s. The country is now, however, politically unstable, having seen three prime ministers since voters went to the polls in 2018. The former ruling party, UMNO, suffered its worst ever election performance. Voters instead turned to Perikatan Nasional and the conservative Islamic party, PAS. Rival parties must now present the name of a candidate they think has the majority support in the lower house of parliament. The stalemate means the backing of parties from eastern Malaysia on the island of Borneo will be essential, and they are expected to press for a better deal for their region under Malaysia's federal system. A regional coalition, Gabungan Parti Sarawak, is willing to work with former Premier Muhyiddin Yassin and the incumbent administration to form a new government, state media has reported. So that's history in the making, first ever hung parliament. So let's see how that happens and what's going to happen over the next couple of days. Last but not least, we'll go into some business with the crypto exchange FTX, right? So big news about this over the last 2 weeks. But it looks like their exchange owes the biggest creditors $3.1 billion. Cryptocurrency exchange FTX owes its 50 largest creditors almost $3.1 billion, according to a court filing. The embattled firm, which filed for bankruptcy in the U.S. last week, says it owes about $1.45 billion to its top 10 creditors, but has not named any. The collapse of the world's second largest crypto exchange shook confidence in the already troubled cryptocurrency market. It also led to exchange boss Sam Bankman-Fried to step down. FTX's previous bankruptcy filings revealed more than 1 million people and businesses could be owed money following its collapse. On Saturday, FTX said it had launched a review of its global assets and was preparing for the sale or reorganization of some businesses. A court hearing before a U.S. bankruptcy judge has been set for Tuesday, and it's unclear how much people who have funds in the exchange will get back at the end of bankruptcy proceedings, though many experts have warned it may be a small fraction of what they put into the firm. Last week, new FTX chief executive John Ray hit out at the way the failed crypto exchange was run, saying he had never seen such a complete failure of corporate controls. Mr. Ray, who replaced Bankman-Fried, criticized a complete absence of trustworthy financial information, and Bankman-Fried told the Vox News website he regretted filing for bankruptcy, saying the decision had largely taken financial matters out of his control. He also expressed disdain for financial regulators. So that is kind of what's going on. It's just getting worse, not just crypto, just in finance in general. We have recessions, we have depression coming, guys. This is going to be pretty bad. But I hope that all of us can really pray for this so that we can get out of this unscathed, all right? So let's go over to some sporting news. And we had the World Cup opener that just happened. And after, you know, there's been tons of controversies and conjecture. And but football was finally kicked in, the Qatar World Cup, 12 years on from being named as host. A day that began with real excitement with the opening ceremony, Qatar's dream turned into a nightmare as they became the first hosts in the competition's history to lose their opening game. Host Qatar opened the 2022 FIFA World Cup in calamitous fashion, easily beaten by Ecuador in a humbling defeat at Al Bayt. The final score was 2-0. So it was just a dramatic opening to the contest. The goalkeeping was very, very bad. And it was so bad that by halftime, like half the stadium already left. They didn't watch the rest of the game, so that's pretty bad. In F1 news, Max Verstappen secures a dominant 15th win in Abu Dhabi, and Charles Leclerc comes in second. So Max Verstappen capped a dominant F1 season with a record-extending 15th win of the year at the Abu Dhabi Grand Prix. Verstappen, who secured the championship with four races to spare, turned in an utterly untouchable performance out in front in what will go down as one of the most impressive title victories in F1's recent history. The previous record of most victories in F1 season was 13, jointly held by Michael Schumacher and Sebastian Vettel. Four-time champion Sebastian Vettel finished 10th in his final F1 race before retirement. Last but not least, we'll go into some tennis news. Novak Djokovic ties Roger Federer with his 6th ATP Finals title. Djokovic claimed a record-equaling 6th ATP Finals title by beating the third-seeded Casper Ruud on Sunday to top a fantastic finish to the season for the Serb. Djokovic won 7-5, 6-3 to secure his first title at the event since 2015 and match Roger Federer's record. 35-year-old Djokovic, who had lost his two previous finals at the event, raised his arms out and smiled broadly after sealing the match with an ace. Djokovic became the oldest champion at the prestigious year-end tournament and also earned the largest payday in tennis history as he walked away with $4.7 million for claiming the ATP Finals trophy undefeated. So there it is, guys. That is the top three news around the world and also in sports. Hope you guys really enjoyed that. But you know what that means. It is the golden time. And yes, it is the golden time, a time of praise and worship to the Holy Trinity. Hope all of you guys are looking forward to giving glory to God and the Holy Spirit. So, what are we going to praise and worship today? We're going to start off with Let's Go, The Time Has Come, the masterpiece of a lifetime, and then we'll end things off with I Have Only God. So, as one body of the Morning Star Drive, let's spend this time giving praise, honor, and glory to the Holy Trinity.
Now we are almost done. Take courage and be strong. If you only sit there drained without any strength, tell me what then can I do? I've come this far looking at you. What can I do? Is there any way I can take your hand? God the Almighty Savior is coming near. He's on his way to converse with you. Will you remain just sitting down? Come on, time to go now. Lift your eyes, see heaven is waiting. The clouds stand still. They wait for you to realize. They're sitting still to help you see and realize. That's it, you are starting to see. On days like this, when we are together, seeing you lead me by the hand is beautiful, my beloved one. Seeing you gives me strength. You're awesome, and that is why I have chosen you. You're just that great, and you have come so far now. You're the masterpiece of my life. The masterpiece of a lifetime. Does not change. You are firm, unwavering. Even as storms rage on, even as winds blow strong, even as the seasons come and go, even if rainstorms and blizzards may come your way, you've never once changed. Your love stays strong. That beauty never fades. Of your life is the air on the breeze, giving off your sweet scent. How fragrant are these lovely days of spring. Beautiful are the days of spring. Days are warm and just like myself, warm and cozy, so bright, so full of
mighty God, I am yours.
bride for all time. From all the world you've chosen me, and now I have firmly set my mind. I will certainly live according to your will. Mighty God, I am yours to love.
That was I Have Only God. Before that, the masterpiece of a lifetime. And of course, Let's Go, The Time Has Come. All right, so now that our hearts are made and prepared, ready through the time of praise and worship, let's get into today's word study for today. And yes, I do have to apologize. I mixed up my mind. It's supposed to be practical word study, but I actually prepared for the scripture for this week, and I'm going to the background in the background of the book of Hebrews. So my apologies, but I will be going into the word study, practical word study tomorrow. So all you guys looking forward to the practical word study, I am so sorry. I just prepared the wrong one by mistake. Maybe my mind is not in the right place right now because we've reached 700 episodes, which is quite possible, but no, it's probably because I just forgot and I mixed it up in my head. That's probably why. Either way, so let's get into this week's scripture that comes from Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. And we're going to take a look at the book of Hebrews. What's the background behind it? Why was it written? Who was it written for? All right? So, you know, let's get into this. So, all throughout history, people of God have suffered persecution throughout. They have, right? Stolen property, beatings, imprisonment, martyrdom. They've all been the fate of countless Christians. And by some reports, Christ's followers are being persecuted more than ever, even in our own day. So it's something that's still actually happening. Now, for those of us who aren't suffering in these ways, it's hard for us to really imagine the temptations that persecution brings, right? So Christians who live in peace and safety often compromise their faith even without threats, right? So we don't even need anything to threaten us for us to not live the proper lifestyle of faith, right? But can you imagine how tempting it would be to compromise what you believe to protect yourself, your spouse, your children, closest friends from serious harm? So how could we possibly encourage fellow believers in these types of conditions? And this was a challenge that faced the author of the book of Hebrews. He wrote to a group of Christians who had suffered in the past and were now threatened with even more suffering. They were already doing well years before, but the author of Hebrews feared that they might now turn away from Christ to avoid further persecution. And this is the first lesson kind of that we're going to learn from the book of Hebrews. And this is kind of like the background and purpose of this book. So through today's word study, we're going to introduce a number of perspectives that should guide our interpretation of this very, very complex book, right? So let's explore the background of the book of Hebrews by considering three topics. We'll look first into its authorship, and then we'll investigate the original audience, and then we'll examine the date when the book of Hebrews was written. So let's first look at authorship. So from the earliest times, there have been a variety of positions on the authorship of Hebrews, and for our purposes, we'll just touch on two issues. So first, we'll discuss the identity of the author, and second, we'll construct a profile for the author by focusing on some features of this book. So let's begin by examining the author's identity. Okay, so identifying the author of Hebrews is not as simple as it is with many other New Testament books, because usually the author will identify themselves, right? But not here. So as early as a patristic period, there's Clement of Alexandria, which is one of those early Christian historians who lived from approximately like 150 to 215 AD, and Origen of Alexandria, who lived from 185 to 254, acknowledged that there was a variety of opinions on the authorship of Hebrews in their day. So early on, the Apostle Paul was a candidate named most frequently, but scholars also suggested Barnabas, even Luke, Apollos, and even Clement of Rome. So around 325 AD, the church historian Eusebius, in his book, History of the Church, referred to Origen's outlook on the authorship of Hebrews in book 6. He basically says that who wrote the book of Hebrews? Only God knows the truth, right? So Origen's comments reflects how uncertain he and many others in his day, in the first, second, third century of Christianity, and most biblical scholars today, they concur only God knows for certain who actually wrote this book. And unfortunately, questions about authorship and the ways some heretical groups misused the book of Hebrews led some people during the patristic period to doubt if Hebrews should be included in the New Testament canon. And of course, notable scholars like Clement of Rome, who died sometime around like 99 AD, treated Hebrews as equal to other New Testament books. And Justin Martyr, who lived from 100 to 165, did the same. But Hebrews was omitted from both the Marcionite canon, written around 144 AD, and the Muratorian canon, written around 170 AD. And by the end of the patristic period, the majority of influential interpreters in the Eastern and Western Church came to recognize Hebrews as part of the canon. So, and they generally agreed that the Apostle Paul was the author. Okay, so that's a general agreement even back then. And throughout the medieval period, most leading scholars continue to believe that Paul wrote Hebrews. But during the Reformation, Protestant reformers questioned many ecclesiastical traditions, including the traditional view of Pauline authorship. So even Martin Luther suggested that Apollos was the author. John Calvin didn't suggest an alternative, but he insisted the book could not have come from Paul. So today, the majority of interpreters reject Pauline authorship, and we're going to touch on three reasons for this stance. And first, as we've already mentioned, this book is anonymous, and it was Paul's practice to name himself in his epistles. In fact, if you look at 2 Thessalonians, it's pretty clear. Paul was deeply concerned that forgeries had spread under his name, so it seems unlikely that he would have failed to identify himself had he written Hebrews. So that's one of those big things. The second thing you have to understand is the book of Hebrews emphasizes subjects that don't receive much, if any, attention in Paul's letters. For instance, the author of Hebrews mentioned Melchizedek three times. He drew attention to the Old Testament tabernacle, and he dealt at length with Christ as the high priest. So taken together, these themes distinguish the book of Hebrews from books that we know were written by Paul. And third, the strongest reason for doubting Pauline authorship is the way the writer of Hebrews distanced himself from the first generation of Jesus' followers. So if you listen to Hebrews chapter 2, verse 3, it says, "This salvation, which was first announced by the Lord, was confirmed to us by those who heard him." Okay, so notice here that the author of Hebrews mentioned how salvation was first announced by the Lord, or basically Jesus, and was confirmed to us by those who heard him. That is, the author and his audience had the gospel verified for them by people who had heard Jesus directly. So the author's admission that he received his Christian faith secondarily contrasts with passages like Galatians and 1 Corinthians, where Paul insisted that he received the gospel directly from Jesus, right? So we look at this, you kind of see that the authorship of the book of Hebrews, and you see that the author's identity remains unknown, and a lot of people say Paul, but when you look at these kinds of evidence, it's kind of like maybe it wasn't Paul, right? So let's take a look at the profile of this author of Hebrews, right? There's just two really distinct things that we have to look at. Number one is he's a Hellenistic Jew. What does that mean? It means, in the first place, the author of Hebrews was a Hellenistic Jew, and most scholars today agree that Paul did not write Hebrews. And in the end, though, it's best to conclude with Origen that only God really knows. So Hebrews authorship has been debated throughout the years, but this shouldn't prevent us from learning as much as we can about the author and his character from clues found in the text. So we can see from the text that both Jewish and Hellenistic influences shaped the author and his book. The author's strong Jewish heritage is evident in his knowledge of the Old Testament. In fact, he quoted the Old Testament at least 31 times in his 13 chapters, right? So people are thinking he's a Jew. But it would also appear that the author had a strong Hellenistic upbringing. In the past, interpreters pointed to the author's use of the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, as evidence that he was a Hellenistic Jew. In the second half of the last century, however, research into the Dead Sea Scrolls has revealed that quotations initially assumed to be directly from the Septuagint could have come from non-traditional Hebrew texts. And for this reason, we can't be certain that the author of Hebrews used the Septuagint, right? So, but despite this discovery, we can still be confident that the author of Hebrews was Hellenistic. His sophisticated Greek offers strong evidence of a Hellenistic upbringing, and his vocabulary and style give evidence of a mastery of the language that even surpasses the writings of Luke. The second thing we need to know about this author is that he is a passionate intellectual. Not only was the author of Hebrews a Hellenistic Jew, but we can also add to our profile that he was a passionate intellectual. So interpreters widely acknowledge that the author of Hebrews was an intellectual. The theological arguments in Hebrews are more complex than many of those found in the rest of the New Testament. In fact, the author himself noted the priority of sophisticated theological reflection in passages like Hebrews chapter 5, verse 13 and 14, where he indicated that to distinguish good from evil, followers of Christ must become doctrinally mature. So even though the author of Hebrews should be considered an intellectual, he was not a cold, detached academic. He was deeply passionate about the Christian faith, and his devotion and passion for his fellow Christians is evident in his writings. So when you look at Hebrews 10, 33, 34, it says, sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times, you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You sympathized with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions, right? So it's difficult to read these and similar passages without realizing that this author was hardly an impersonal scholar. He was passionate about his audience and Christ. And if we miss his passion, we miss one of the book's most prominent features, right? So let's get into the audience now, the original audience. The book of Hebrews doesn't clearly identify its audience by name, city, or region. But still, in general terms, we can be confident that the author wrote to a specific audience with whom he has personally familiar, right? So in chapter 13, verse 19 to 24, the author assured his audience of his intent to visit them again. And he spoke of Timothy, whom he called our brother. And he also mentioned a group of people from Italy that his audience apparently knew. Now we'll look at five important factors about his original audience that we should consider as we study the book of Hebrews. All right, so let's take a look at five important factors about this audience. Number one is Jewish. There's reason to think that at least a good portion of the original audience was Jewish. And Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 makes it pretty clear. The author referred to how God had revealed himself to Israel in the Old Testament, but notice how he called Old Testament Israelites our forefathers, the ancestors of the author and his audience. So it's no wonder that from as early as the time of Tertullian, who lived from about 155 to 230 AD, the traditional title attached to this book has been Pros Hebraeus, or it means for the Hebrews. The second factor that we'll see about the audience is they're Hellenistic. So it's also likely that the audience was in large part Hellenistic. The content of Hebrews indicates that the audience was familiar with theological teachings that were more common among Jews living outside of Palestine than among more traditional Jewish circles within Palestine. And a number of interpreters have tried to determine where the audience may have lived outside of Palestine. The fact that the first epistle of Clement of Rome referred to the book as early as 95 AD has led some to suggest that the audience was in Rome. Now, Hebrews 13:24 has been used to support this point of view because it mentions those from Italy, and these suggestions are interesting, but the most we can say with any degree of confidence is that the original audience consisted in large part of Hellenistic Jews who lived outside of Palestine. The third factor we can look at is their maturity. The original audience of Hebrews was immature. Listen to the way the author described them in Hebrews 5:12. Though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truth of God's word all over again. Very famous verse. And you notice that the audience had been believers long enough for the author to say, by this time you ought to be teachers. So they should have made great doctrinal progress, but as the author noted, they needed to be taught the elementary truths of God's word all over again. And interestingly enough, even though the audience was theologically immature, the book of Hebrews contains some of the most advanced, sophisticated theological teachings in the entire New Testament. How do these features of the book fit with the immaturity of the audience? The best way to make sense of this situation is to keep in mind that early Christians adopted a common practice used in first century synagogues. So we'll learn in like passages from Luke and Acts and 1 Timothy that leaders of synagogues and Christian churches supervise the reading and explanation of scriptures to their congregations. So the author of Hebrews wrote some of the most theologically sophisticated New Testament writings because he expected church leaders to teach his book to their congregants. So in Hebrews chapter 5, verse 11, the writer of Hebrews reprimanded his audience for being slow to learn. So it's quite possible that the large portion of the original audience remained theologically immature because they didn't properly respect their leaders, all right? The next thing that we'll look at, the fourth thing is they were persecuted. So the original audience of Hebrews was persecuted, and there were two well-known times of persecution for Christians during the first century AD that may have impacted Hebrews' original audience, at least indirectly. In AD 49, the Roman Emperor Claudius expelled Jews from the city of Rome, and around 64 AD, Emperor Nero persecuted Christians in the vicinity of Rome. So as we read through the book of Hebrews, it becomes evident that the original audience had already faced persecution in the past. Some of them were suffering in the present, and the author's expectation was that more of them would suffer, perhaps even more severely in the future. In chapter 10, verse 32-35, the author of Hebrews drew attention to the suffering that at least some in the audience had experienced in the past. And he says, remember those earlier days after you had received the light when you stood your ground in a great contest in the face of suffering. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. Right? And here we see that the author praised his audience for their strength when they were persecuted in those earlier days after they had first received the light. But he also encouraged them not to throw away their confidence. And the Greek term translated confidence here is paresia, which in many contexts means courage, boldness, or fearlessness in the presence of dignitaries. And this word choice suggests that the audience was facing public or official persecution of some sort, and they were tempted to lose their boldness. So in chapter 13, verse 3, the author also referred directly to present persecutions when he said, remember those in prison as if you were their fellow prisoners, and those who are mistreated as if you yourselves were suffering. So we can see from the verse that the author exhorted his audience to remember those in prison as if they were fellow prisoners, and to remember those mistreated, right? So it's not clear, it's clear that not all of his audience's persecution was in the past. So in addition to persecution in the past and in the present, the author of Hebrews acknowledged that his audience was facing the threat of more persecution in the future, and that you'll find that in chapter 12, right? So you'll see that they were persecuted. And last but not least, what's the fifth thing about our audience? They were near apostasy. Right? So those of you guys, we've been learning this word a lot. Apostasy means getting ready to leave the faith, right? Not getting ready. If you're apostasy means to leave the faith, right? So the audience of Hebrews faced persecution. At least some of them were near apostasy. And rather than simply being discouraged or weakened by sufferings, they were in danger of turning away from Christ entirely. So if you look at Hebrews chapter 10, verse 26-27, there is a warning. That the author said, if we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Okay? And, you know, we got to be clear that the author of Hebrews was not concerned about peccadilloes or small sins. He warned his audience severely because for those who utterly turned away from Christ, right? No sacrifice for sins is left. And when people reject the Christian faith, like some of the original audience of Hebrews were tempted to do, they prove that they never had faith that saves. And for this reason, they can only have a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire reserved for the enemies of God. And as we'll explain in our next lesson, in the next coming weeks, you're going to see that similar passages don't imply that true believers can lose their salvation. But we'll get into that a little bit later. All right. So let's get into the dates. Although the exact date for Hebrews remains uncertain, the earliest and latest dates for this book can be established rather firmly. We'll look first at the earliest possible date for the book, or the terminus a quo, and then at the latest possible date, or terminus ad quem. So both of these dates can be determined with some degree of confidence using scriptural and historical evidence. So on the one side, Hebrews chapter 13, verse 23 helps confirm the earliest possible date for the book in this verse the author wrote. He says, I want you to know that our brother Timothy has been released. If he arrives soon, I will come with him to see you. And that's Hebrews 13:23, right? And here we see that Timothy had been released recently from prison. We don't hear of Timothy's imprisonment anywhere else in the New Testament. In fact, in the book of 2 Timothy, Paul's last letter written shortly before his death, Timothy was free to travel and bring Paul supplies. Yet this verse tells us that by the time Hebrews was written, Timothy had been imprisoned and released. So for this reason, the book of Hebrews must have been written after Paul's death, which took place sometime around 65 AD. Okay? Now on the other side, the latest likely date for the book would be around 95 AD, shortly before Clement of Rome referred to the book of Hebrews in his letter. In addition, many commentators have observed that in passages like Hebrews chapter 5, verse 1-3, the authors use the present tense to describe the sacrificial duties of the high priest. And this is important because in the rest of his book, the author consistently used the Greek past tense when referring to past events. So it's likely that these priestly activities were still going on when Hebrews was written. And also in chapter 8, the author encouraged his audience not to turn back to the obsolete sacrificial practices established by God's covenant with Moses. And he explained that in light of the new covenant, these practices would soon disappear. So we know that the high priest's activities and the Levitical sacrificial system as a whole came to an end in AD 70 when the Romans destroyed Jerusalem and its temple. So these evidences suggest a date for Hebrews somewhere after Paul's death around 65 AD. and before this destruction of the temple in 70 AD, okay? And if anything else, if we're just to look at a simple purpose of this book of Hebrews, basically, it's fair to say that any book as long and complex as the book of Hebrews is written with many different purposes in mind. But for us to think about this a little more simply, we're primarily interested in summarizing the overarching purpose of the book. And each part of this book has its own emphasis, and exploring these emphases is something that's really important. And just want to show how the book as a whole was designed to impact the concepts, behaviors, and emotions of the original audience. So a lot of people have summarized the overarching purpose of the book of Hebrews in a variety of ways, but we'll describe it as like the author of Hebrews wrote to exhort his audience to reject local Jewish teachings and to remain faithful to Jesus. So there's one of the purposes there was. And another one here would probably say that his audience received his book as a word of exhortation. And basically, what that means is the terminology of exhortation implies to summon to the speaker's side or to call for someone to take the speaker's point of view. And the same expression is used to describe John the Baptist's urgent persuasive call for repentance, right? So it's something that when you look at this is like, yeah, this is one of those books. He's basically going to his audience, asking him to take his side, but to reject the local teachings, a Jewish teaching, and to remain faithful to Jesus as kind of like the main purpose of this book too. So that's something I do think that's very, very important for us to understand also. But if anything else, it's a very, very short book. Go ahead, take a look at it. I hope that you guys will really, really enjoy this, all right? So there it is, guys. That is the book of Hebrews, the background behind it. I hope you guys really enjoyed that. Leave a comment below if you have anything that you want to add to the book of Hebrews. But I'm very grateful and thankful that all of you guys have joined and listened to this, all right? So there it is, guys. That is the book of Hebrews, the word study for today. Remember, tomorrow we will do the practical word study. So let's get into today's song of choice for today. And today's song of choice on this Japanese Tuesday is from Matsuda Seiko. And this song is called Anata ni Aitakute.
ことない愛もあるか
And there it is on this Japanese Tuesday. That's Matsuda Seiko with Anata ni Aitakute. I'm not sure what that means. And I don't think I really even pronounced that last part right. But if you're Japanese out there, go ahead and let me know what that means. And did I pronounce it right or not? Anata ni Aitakute. It feels like I'm speaking like Native Indian or something like that. Either way. So there it is. Japanese Tuesday. Hope you guys enjoyed that song. I'm not sure if many of you guys know what that song is. I've heard that song before. It feels like an older song, though, by the way. Okay? So now that we have that last song under the, out of the way, let's get into today's Pravi in the Media. And of course, this is something that I think that a lot of people are really, really wondering about, as we just had the first trial last Friday. And, you know, what actually happened during it. I believe it happened around 10 a.m. in Korea time. And during that trial, it's kind of like any other trial too. It's going to be before the trial starts. That first day is they announce what are the charges. And then, of course, the defendant or Sunseem has to plead guilty or innocent. Or basically in this, it's possible if he wanted to take the easy way out, he could have just said, all right, I confess to everything, and then he would have got a lighter sentence, right? But of course, you know, we know Sunseem, innocent until the end. He's not gonna confess something he didn't even do. And this is something that must be done, is the truth has to come out. And he denied all charges. And basically that was like the what actually happened during that trial. And the next trial is set for December 18th. So guys, I hope this is something that we all realize and recognize, that now that we know the next date of the trial, we can pray until that next date. It's already the 22nd, which means we have over 3 weeks to pray for this new trial. And this is kind of where the real trial actually begins. All the investigation evidence comes out. And it's presented before the judge, all the testimonies and stuff like that too. So this is a very, very big thing. Now, remember when I talked about this, was it last week or the week before, of how the trials work? Remember one thing about the Korean criminal justice system, the one thing that you can really say is that innocent until proven guilty, that is how the Korean court system does it. However, when you look at the statistics of all the court proceedings, of all the cases that come before the judges, only 0.05% is actually acquitted. 0.05%, which means that whenever the prosecutors bring a case, right, when they find it's enough evidence, they come before the judge, 99.95% of all cases, like, the person's guilty. They'll side with the prosecutor, which means we are fighting an uphill battle. It's going to be a very, very big uphill battle. But the reason I'm telling you this is not to discourage you. The reason I'm telling you this, so we know the reality of the situation, so we know how much we need to pray. And if for some miracle that Sunseem gets acquitted, you'll know how great the miracle actually is, right? Because it's that hard to get an acquittal. Right, so there's the first thing that we have to keep in mind. The second thing is, when we're praying for this, of course, there's a thing that we absolutely want. And you know, I would say the best way to pray for this situation is to pray like Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, right? He said, God, take this cup away from me, not as my will, but your will be done. Which means that there were two things that were talked about when in Jesus, in that short prayer, there's two things. It is what Jesus wants, but what Jesus eventually wants to happen, right? What Jesus wanted was not to go through the cross and get this. He wanted the cup taken away from him. However, in the end, he wanted it only if it was God's will. And that's something, one of the prayers that we really have to think about, right? Because remember, when you understand Jesus's what Jesus went through, Jesus was the Messiah, and his whole goal was to save as many people as possible. Which means, why is he saying, I don't want to do this, but I want to do your will? Because at that point, what was the best method? What was the best path for more people to be saved? And at that point, it was him going to the cross and dying for their sins, right? Even though it wasn't plan A, that was the best path. And what we need to recognize here too is, yes, there is the path that we want. And we want him to be acquitted. We don't want him to go through that junk again. We don't want that. However, in our hearts, we also have to think about God's will. Has the situation tilted to the point where there's no other way but for Sunseem to go back in there? Has it tilted that bad, right? So there's another thing we have to think about is our prayer has to be appropriate. Yes, there is our will, what we want, but we also have to consider God. What is going to be better for this history in the long run? What happens to Sunseam, right? And I would say if there's anything else that I would add to this when it comes to our prayers, it's kind of in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus was praying, the disciples were praying at the same time, but instead they fell asleep. And what Sunseam said earlier was, he says, if those disciples made up their hearts and minds to run hard and take the responsibility of the history, then at that point, Jesus would not have to go to the cross. Which means that we do play a role of how we are going to run from this point on. How will we run? How will we go out and make history? And that is something that we have to really, really think about, right? Are we just going to say, let him free, and then we still live our lives the exact same way as we did before? Or are we going to say, God, no. If you let him off this time, you know what I'm going to do, God? I'm going to do this. I've got to live like this. I've got to be like this. I've got to support the church. I've got to be the one that preaches the gospel. I've got to be the one that makes sure that, you know, like, you have to think about that is, you can't just say, God, let everything work out fine, but we're all going to live our life the exact same way it was. That led to this situation to come like this anyways, right? So if we're going to just live the exact same way, then what's the point of praying for him to come out when it's just going to end up happening the exact same thing again? We need to pray that, what am I going to do then? What will I do after, like, if you let him free, what am I going to do? And that's something that you need to pray. It's between you and God, right? You got to figure that out. We have to be the ones that not only just pray and say, God, I want this, but remember, everything has a price. Everything costs something. And if we don't recognize this, then what's going to happen is we're going to, it's almost like when you ask God for patience, God's going to start testing you. So he trains you to have more patience, right? Just like me, 8-9 things happened in my first 3 weeks to test my patience so that I'm trained to be that much better, right? And in the same way too, we have to realize that with this trial and the next trial coming December 18th, one thing I think all of us have to recognize is Sunseam may be in trial for all of 2023. Why? It's not this trial. This trial's not going to last that long. I think it'll last maybe 2 to 4 months, maybe. So then you're like, well, Pastor Sky, why would it last for the entire 2023? Because it's possible, because, you know, it's a 99.95% chance of him being, you know, tried and sentenced, right? Which means what's the next process? Which is appeal. Which means he'll go to another trial to appeal it. And then after that, if that doesn't go through, it goes to the Supreme Court. And if it goes to the Supreme Court, what happens is that means 3 trials in a year, which basically means anywhere from 2 to 4 months, which is going to be the entire year if things don't work out as they should, right? And if you think about this, remember what happened in the first trial. In the first trial, you know, Sunseam was actually sentenced only 6 years. He was sentenced 6 years, and then he appealed and went to the Supreme Court, right? And the Supreme Court upheld the lower court's decision. But not only did they upheld the lower court's decision, they lengthened the sentence from 6 to 10 years. So that's the risk that happens if you take it all the way to the Supreme Court, right? So when we're looking at this, it's very, very possible we'll be sitting here in a 1 year condition, just praying for Sunseam's situation. So I really, really pray and hope that all of us will get our hearts and our minds really thinking about and praying about Sunseam's situation, and we'll do things in the right way. All right. So this is the update for what just happened. It wasn't a big trial, anything like that. It was the sentence, and he was pleading. He pleaded innocent and he did not confess to anything. And then the next trial is set for December 18th. I hope that's something that kind of opens your eyes up to what is happening right now. And it allows you to pray even better for Sunseam at this time, knowing the full situation. Okay, so there it is, guys. That is Pravi in the Media. I hope you guys really enjoyed that. If you have anything else, just leave it in the comments below. We'd love to hear what your thoughts are. And I really hope that all of us can pray even better conditions for Sunseam, all right? All right, so there it is. That is Pravi in the Media. I hope you guys enjoyed today's Tuesday podcast. Everyone have an amazing, awesome, great, just exhilarating day. Let's pray for the entire situation. And we'll see you guys again tomorrow on the Morningstar Drive on 117.8.
The Morning Star Drive 117.8. You soaring up with Sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
I'm burning with desire and the passion.